70s and 80s, not a lot of syncopation was happening. And there was one song, actually it was playing for a quartet, and it was Easy One, and it was syncopated. And Kathleen Deering, who Bob is quite aware of, maybe others, she put in a complaint on me. And she said that Murray Archibald was dancing at the piano. And how did she know I was dancing at the piano? Because I was hauled up on the carpet and we pulled this. And I said, well, how do you do that? And she said, she could see air between my bottom and the piano bench. And I said, well, what is she looking at that for? Anyway, here we go. With that, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
And welcome to our service. As we were listening to the Springmans, and we'll be introducing our guests momentarily, but they were, it was so much country, I had to go and get my hat again. And I couldn't listen to the music and not wear the hat, so that explains that. But welcome to our service this afternoon. We are in for a wonderful afternoon of worship. We are here to give praise and glory and honor to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm just wondering, Debbie, I saw Debbie here earlier. Debbie, are you here? Are you here with your shofar?
Negative.
So, Neil, you're up. Let's. Let's stand as we hear the sounds of the shofar. From day to day. I'm going to ask that you be seated for a moment, and we indeed do want to welcome the Springman family, and come on up, and I'm sure you will be introducing yourselves, each one, but it's such a joy to have this family of musicians come and minister to us today, and God bless you, and may your heart truly be enriched today as we hear the word of God in song. Amen. Amen. Let's welcome our friends.
Shabbat.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Well, it's a great honor and joy to be here with you today and with my family. And I am the dad. My wife Julia is back there. So my name is Perry, and that's Julia back there. Julia, just raise your hand. There you are. And we live in Langley with our four kids. I'm going to let them introduce themselves and say your favorite song that we sing. Okay.
My name is Ryan. I'm 15 years old. I play drums and mandolin. And my favorite song that we play is called All You Shining Stars.
My name is Jacob. I'm 12. I play violin and percussion. And my favorite song to perform is Hear Israel.
My name is Sarah. I am 13 years old. And I play the piano. And I think my favorite is also Hear Israel.
Hello, my name is Emma. And I play the mandolin and the ukulele. And, well, I have a lot of favorites. I won't kind of put you through all that. I'd say mostly all of them. But one particular I love is called Marvelous.
My favorite song is Hero Israel as well, and yes, we'll play that song a little bit later. Alright, so I'm going to start with a worship song called Behold, God is My Salvation. If you like to stand and sing, you're welcome to do that. If you want to sit, you know, it's a free country, so mostly it is. Come on, put your hands together. Now, we don't get to play for a Messianic congregation. Messianic light, is that right? But we expect great things from you when we do, okay? Here we go. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. Second part, you probably know it, goes like this. It's in Hebrew. La 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 la. You're very quick. Good. Now let's see if we can do the whole thing in Hebrew, okay? Everybody's got to do the hey, though. Hey? Okay? We don't normally do that, but I just feel like we should. Okay, so we're going to do the chorus. Ready? La 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 la.
Hey!
Yeah!
There we go.
There you go.
went to a Jewish wedding, they do a lot of that. Hey! And it's pretty fun. I went to my first Jewish wedding when I was probably like 5, and I still remember, you know, these old men with the wine bottles on their heads, on their hats, and doing the, you guys ever seen, if you've seen Fiddler on the Roof, you've seen that, or any of those kind of movies. And that was, it's kind of funny how that like sticks out in my memory. I don't remember even who the bride and groom were. I remember these old men dancing. It was crazy. It was so fun. Okay. This one is called Shalu Shalom Yerushalayim. You know this one?
Yes, we do.
Now this song kind of progressively gets faster, right? And if you want to do the grapevine, you guys know how to do that? No? Yeah. Pastor Murray hasn't taught you that yet? It's okay. Ready? Shalu shalom Yerushalayim. Shalu shalom Yerushalayim. Shalu shalom Yerushalayim. Shalu shalom Yerushalayim. Let's do that again. Shalu shalom Yerushalayim. Shalom Yerushalayim. Shalom Shalom Yerushalayim. Shalom Shalom Yerushalayim. Now we sing Shalom.
Shalom, shalom, shalom.
want to introduce this next song?
Sure.
This is Ryan's favorite song, right?
Is that what he said?
That's what he said.
Okay. So this is Ryan's favorite song, in case you didn't hear. And it is called All You Shining Stars. It is one of our newest songs from our new album. And it's taken from Psalm 148. And it has a call and answer to it. Okay, you can feel free to sit down if you like. And so there's a call and answer to it. So the boys are going to sing one part, and the girls are going to sing the other. So praise him is the boys' part, and then the answer is the ladies' part. So it's going to go,
praise him.
All his angels.
Praise him.
All his hosts.
Praise him.
Sun and moon.
Praise him.
And every once in a while, at the end of the chorus, it'll say, all you shining stars. And then we will all sing that last line, and you're also going to put your hands up. Twinkle like stars.
Got to twinkle. Twinkle your fingers.
All right.
This isn't just for kids, right? You know, the Bible says that we're his children. It doesn't say we're his adults. His cool, it doesn't say we're his cool, sophisticated adults. Or even teenagers or 20-somethings or anything. It just says we're his children. And I think there's a good reason for that, because it's just not right that kids have all the fun, right? So the inner child is still there, and some of you, it's really apparent. I like that. It's really obvious. Some of us are trying to contain it, but yeah. Okay, so guys, your part, it's on purpose, but guys, your part's the simplest. Because, yeah, she's like, yeah, guys are simple. It's true, we are. Okay. Right. I'll try that. That's better. Alright, so. Alright, guys, you ready? I'm Chris. Ladies.
All you shining stars.
has been doing, well, I've been doing music for many, many years. I used to live in San Diego, California, and I worked at a church there for a number of years as a youth pastor. That's how I started in music ministry. Somebody gave me a guitar and said, if you're gonna be a youth pastor, you better learn how to play guitar, right? Or something. And since you can't really take a piano to the beach very easily, I learned guitar and just started writing songs. However God inspired me, I'd start writing songs and eventually started, you know, kind of leading worship at our church. They didn't have a contemporary service at our church, but we started one. And then from there, I got opportunities to lead worship in different churches and for youth events, and just started writing more and more songs. And then I felt like God was saying, you know, you need to step out. And it was a big step from a regular kind of a paycheck job working at a church to doing full-time music ministry. And so I launched that into that, just took this like a step into space almost. And okay, God, this will probably last about 2 weeks, and I'm going to have to, you know, be looking for a real job somewhere. But I moved out to the Midwest. I moved to Minneapolis, Minnesota, and got involved in just kind of leading worship in different churches and working with different churches and doing kind of music ministry there. And eventually put a band together, toured all over the Midwest, all over the United States, and then we got an opportunity to go over to Europe and Eastern Europe. And so this was before the Berlin Wall came down, so it was still during the Soviet times in Europe. And so yeah, it was before, it was still, you know, during the Soviet times, and so had opportunities to play in, you know, a number of different Soviet countries, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland was still a part of the Soviet bloc, and then even into Russia proper. And, you know, met a lot of interesting people, saw a lot of amazing things, saw God do things that I never thought were possible, because up until then everything was kind of measured according to what I had seen happen in, you know, North America and Canada and the U.S. And you know, here in Canada and the U.S. there's, you know, churches on every other corner, and you know, to be a Christian is not that of an unusual thing. To be a believer in Yeshua is not that unusual. And but going into some of these Eastern European countries, especially into the Soviet bloc countries, where for, you know, decades people had been, it had been basically illegal to preach the gospel, to read the Bible, to have a Bible. So it was pretty incredible to play, you know, concerts in these places and see so many people come to the Messiah, so many people hungry for the Word. And that really just kind of launched me into this new direction. Of course, while it was sending me in this one direction, it really sent my parents over the edge. Because growing up in a Jewish home, my parents both were Jewish, and you know, for them to have a son who wasn't doing what everybody else in the family did, was doing something very, very different and really outside of what they ever thought any of their kids would do. That hurt them deeply, and you know, my father especially, I think it really hurt him, because he was in the Second World War, and I think he still had held a lot of that anger of what he saw, and what he didn't see. He saw very little, you know, of the churches doing anything to protect and shelter the Jewish people. So he came back from that, but he's still a loving person, but, you know, he didn't have a lot of good thoughts about the Christian church. And so here his son, you know, does the worst thing possible, to so treacherous, to basically go over to the enemy. And and I grew up in it was a conservative Jewish home. I had a bar mitzvah. And so for them, you know, to have all that, you know, life that I had been living, and then to, you know, basically defect and turn away, it was a very hard thing for them. and even for the rest of my family, my brothers and sister. That was a really shameful thing for them, and they sent me to, you know, they sent me to see the rabbi a couple times, and that didn't do any good. I just confused him because I didn't have any answers for his, you know, deep theological questions. I mean, I'd been a believer for, you know, like 2 months, and my parents found out because they found Bibles. Oh, horrible Bibles. You know, I used to sneak out of my house so I could go to church on Sunday morning. While all my other friends from school were sneaking out of the house to go to parties and stuff, I was sneaking out to go to church. But I went to see the rabbi, and he tried to, you know, show me through what he, you know, saw in Scripture that, you know, Jesus could not have been the Messiah. And finally, I just said, look, I don't have any answers for all this stuff that you're throwing at me. I said, and I was trying to be respectful, but I got frustrated. I just said, look, all I know is that I'm different now, and I didn't do it. Right? To that, he had no, I mean, I didn't understand it. I did not understand it completely. All I knew is that the changes that were in me, there's no way I could have done it.
Amen.
And isn't that the truth? Yes. Right? So, you know, after a couple of visits, I think he kind of gave up, and I realized that, you know, I didn't want to torture the poor guy anymore. But as I was growing in my faith, I came to understand a little bit more about the, you know, about what the hope that I had. You know, when you become a believer in Yeshua, you don't understand it all. You just accept it. And then as you grow as a believer, you start to learn more and you grow more. And I'm starting to get a few things a little bit more now than I did when I was in my 20s. You know, and we all kind of learn as we go. But the faith part, that stays consistent and it grows. So anyway, down through the years, you know, I eventually, you know, like I said, I was working and doing music and started a band and toured all over Europe and Eastern Europe and Australia and through North America, Canada, and the U.S. And then met Julia at Bible camp here in British Columbia, and you know, knew I didn't want to be away from home so much without Julia. So that didn't work out so good. So then we just started traveling with the band, and then we realized, you know, once we were having kids, that I didn't want to be away. It was no fun to be away from your family and come back home. And fortunately, I don't think, did I ever miss any first steps with the kids? I don't think so. I was pretty careful about that. And that's before, you know, Skype and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So, you know, you could just hear about it through a fax or something, which is not the same thing as being there. And so, eventually, you know, kids came along. And Emma was obviously the first. She's the oldest. And when she was about 4 years old, came with me. Down to, and I still remember this so vividly, and she's heard me tell this story so much. Like, do you want to just tell it? You should probably do it better. But so here we are. So Ryan is just a baby, and Emma is about 4, so Ryan's maybe a year old. And Julia says, why don't you take Emma with you? And I was going down to Salem, Oregon, playing at a couple of schools, Christian schools, and a church. Sure, you know, it'd be great, a little daddy date kind of thing, and we love to do those kinds of things. So packed up, I packed up all the stuff, and then Emma brought her a little bag, snack bag, I guess. But I still remember we were playing at this Christian school in Salem, and it was just me. Usually I'd be playing with the band, but on this one it was just me in front of about 400 middle school and high school kids, which is, normally it's okay, but I'm feeling a little bit like, naked without the rest of the band. But Emma, she came up on the stage, and she didn't want to, because she didn't want to sit down in the chairs with the kids, she wanted to be close to daddy. And so she came up, and I still remember she's sitting there over on the edge of the stage, her little legs dangling over the edge of the stage, you know, kicking in sort of in time with the music, but not really, and eating her snack. And every once in a while, she'd kind of look up at me or come over and give my leg a hug. But then she would like start singing along, because by the time she's 4, she knows all of my songs, probably better than I do. Can you imagine now how well she knows my songs? But I noticed as she was singing along, the kids in the, you know, sitting out there were like really into it. Just watching her singing along to the songs, more so than if I didn't have Emma up there. And that was when the germ of an idea began to do this. And so, you know, a couple years later, Emma's learning how to play ukulele. She'd come up on stage, we'd give her a mic, wouldn't plug it in, but we'd give her a mic, and she'd sing along. So actually, you know what, that's not true. We often did just turn it on anyway. And she would just sing, and the kids didn't care. It was like that just encouraged them to sing even more. And so anyway, eventually Ryan comes along, he's playing. By the time he's 2 years old, he's taught himself how to play drums. Believe it or not, this kid, when he was 2 years old, could play a beat. And my wife and I thought, that's pretty weird, but he could do it. And so we just let him go and got him drums and things like that. And then they teach themselves. You just put the stuff out there and they teach themselves. So I have forgotten what song we're doing now. Okay, Greater You Are. All right. So anyway, I want to give you a little background. Sorry, I kind of talked, but I want to give you a little background on this, because as I've been doing this for a number of years now with our family, and this is our full-time work. Yes, it's a little scary, and I'm thinking, you know, we don't have any other income other than doing what we do, but I have to remind myself, I mean, this is the dream job, to be able to do this with my family. I mean, who wouldn't like to be able to do that? I grew up, our family owned a gas station. It's not the same thing. We worked at a gas station together. Similar, but not really. Sarah's like, yeah, this is a lot like a gas station. Anyway, I'm very thankful for this. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the dark. Heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. You only Sarah's favorite song. And I grew up in Saskatchewan, and once a week, our family would drive about 60 miles from a place called Nipawin to a place called Melfort, Saskatchewan, where we would get our, my brother and I would get our Hebrew lessons for, what they call mafter lesson, of course, for our bar mitzvah. And Mr. Mollerman was our teacher, and he was a very interesting guy. I still remember he smoked these cigars, and we always got Tang to drink. It's great. And he was an interesting guy. He ended up writing a song, a book that I found later, because he was a Holocaust survivor, and he escaped from a concentration camp. And he has a book out, it's called The Fugitive, not to be confused with Harrison Ford in the movie. This was way before that. Really cool. It's not a very long book, but it was a really amazing story. And just to think, this guy taught us, just, you know, very humble man, taught us Hebrew, taught us our mafter for our bar mitzvah. So this particular song that we're going to do next means so much to me, because this is, you know, the great Shema, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, which my brother and I, we learned that, of course. And now later, years later, I'm writing songs for our new worship album, and I thought, this has got to be, I've got to write something that is, you know, going to incorporate and encompass the Shema. And so this is a song that we love doing and means so much. And it's got such a great biblical story and heritage in it. So feel free to sing with us. You can sing in Hebrew. I've written it out in phonetically, but if there's anybody here that reads Hebrew, that's it below. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai
your children every day. Write them on the door frames of your homes and gates. Bye.
Thanks so much. I think we're going to come back and do one song at the end. So, Pastor Murray, there you are.
Amen. Thank you so much. I just want to remind you that the Springmans have a literature table, that's old school, a CD table at the back, and also just be reminded that there is an offering basket on their table for donations for their ministry. As was mentioned, this is their full-time ministry to the Lord, so do be generous with them. They also receive by e-transfers, and I think there's other methods as well that they can let you know concerning. So it's a joy, isn't it, to be here today?
Amen.
Praise God. Well, let's stand and take some time, not a lot of time, but a little bit, to meet and greet one another in the name of Yeshua. Let's stand and do that right now. Classes Heavenly Father, in the name of Yeshua, we thank you for our children. We pray your blessing upon them. Thank you for the music that we have enjoyed. And Lord, may there be a melody in their hearts. We pray in the name of Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
So just go down the aisle there and you will be directed to your classes. Amen. Hallelujah. There are announcements on the back of your bulletin. I'm sure you can read. There are Bible studies. There's ladies' group. The address is not on the bulletin for the ladies' group for Sunday, February 12th. Teresa, is that at your mom's?
Yes.
Okay. So if you need to know where that is, Teresa can let you know. That's Sunday, February 12th, so in about a week's time or so. And Zoom Bible study on Tuesday evenings as well. My wife, Marta, thanks you for your prayers. She's gradually improving, and she hopes to be here next week. And you will see her rejoicing in the Lord. We are meeting on Monday with our elders, Ron and Janet, for anointing with oil for our sister, my wife, Marta. Your sister, my wife, and we're believing that God will indeed raise her fully to health and strength again.
Amen.
And for each one in need of prayer, we know that God is more than enough, more than able. By his stripes, you were healed. Donna, you had a... There's something happening in mission. Can you just let us know?
At the Church of Zion tomorrow in Mission, Melody Gray Eyes and her husband will be there. They are a blessing since they're here yesterday. Yeah. They are with the Kanata House, a house of blessing in Jerusalem to bless the Jewish people. So I'm sure they'll be really good.
And what time is that?
That will be, I'll say 10, so you're there early.
So 10 a.m. Okay.
I'll second that. It's a very good talk.
And that's at Zion?
Very, very amazing.
Amen. Okay. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you. When we have a service like this, our hearts are, you know, they jump. They do jump for joy. There's a spring, there's a step, there's something fresh. The scripture tells us to sing a new song to the Lord. Praise him, Yeshua, our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals loud with Hosanna's ring. God inhabits the praises of his people. So sing of your Redeemer. Instead of a midrash today, and I know there's two different hymn books in your pews, but we're going to do a few favorites from this hymn book, Celebration Hymnal. So just have that in mind. We'll just do a few favorites after this very short message, but indeed we want to bring our hearts around the Word of God. And I think of Exodus 15 in our parasha reading this week, concerning the song of Moses. And after the crossing of the Red Sea, what an amazing deliverance, not just a miracle, but a full and free deliverance of redemption. A blood-bought people, blood-bought by the Passover lamb, and then gone through the sea, baptized through that water, and then on the other side, fully redeemed, as they were all safe and sound. And they looked back and they saw that sea come back over the chariots and the horsemen, then Pharaoh himself. And it made a song rise up in Moses' heart. Then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord, to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, and spoke, saying, I will sing to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. For he has triumphed gloriously, the horse and its rider is thrown into the sea.
The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my Yeshua, my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has cast into the sea. He has chosen captains. His chosen captains are also drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank to the bottom like a stone. That doesn't sound like 3 feet of water to me. That sounds like a very major place that the Israelites crossed over. And it brought about this song to our great God, to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. A remarkable theme rose up in their hearts. Imagine singing a song of horses and riders, and they were all drowned. It's not exactly, you know, necessarily something on the number one charts on our radios, you know. Well, the horse and rider drowned. But for the children of Israel, it was their deliverance. And we can't sit, we can't read those words without the song that, you know, has come about in our day. I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and rider thrown into the sea. I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and rider thrown into the sea. The Lord my God, my strength, my song, has now become my victory. The Lord my God, my strength, my song, has now become my victory. Hallelujah. What power, what presence, what a song of joy, what a song of victory, of salvation to Yeshua. The scripture tells us that we should sing to the Lord a new song. The Bible says, in as Paul gives us instruction, that make melody in your hearts to the Lord. We express our prayers to God. We express our prayers in prose, but also in poetry. We teach our children how to pray, sometimes in poetry, don't we? God is great, God is good, let us thank him for his, for this food. It's too bad good and food don't actually rhyme. But here we have this wonderful expression of truth. It's so important as we sing, as we give the praise to God that is due his name, that what we sing is true. We are not singing from just words that we think of. I remember when I was preaching, pastoring one place, and our song leader wrote his own stuff, and I call it stuff for a reason. And everything started with I. And I'm embarrassed almost to tell this, because he would come and lead the singing, and then during the sermon he would time it so that he would go out to the coffee shop and have a coffee and a cigarette while he waited for the sermon to be over, and then he would come back to lead the last song. I was none too happy about that. And he came to me one time and he said, you know, I really believe that God wants me, you know, to be more in leadership. And I said, well, I'm really not sure about that, you know, how, you know, trying to be very kind. And then he looked at me straight in the eye and said, you just don't want Satan up on your platform, do you? And I said, well, no, I don't. And that was the last we saw of him. And then we went through all the, what used to be, we used to use transparencies. Anybody remember what those are? Overhead projector. Went through all his transparencies and started checking all those things. God has a way of bringing about truth one way or the other. It was General Booth of the Salvation Army, and he was one of many who reportedly said, why should the devil have all the good tunes? And he indeed brought about the good words, and others the good words of the gospel to our music. Hallelujah. But the Lord being our strength, being the Almighty God, He is our song. He is the theme of our message today and each day. We should be singing with joy and praise in our hearts. Amen. And this is the song of God. This is the song of the Almighty. Moses sang it with the children of Israel. But who inspired this message and song? Who was the inspiration behind it? The Holy Spirit of the living God. The Lord is your strength, your song, and your salvation. Did you know that this is one of the first places where that scripture is spoken? And then it's spoken again in the Psalms as David quotes this, and then again in the writings of God. And in the prophets as well, in Isaiah, speaks of the Lord as your strength and your song and your salvation. And what did Yeshua say concerning who he was? He said, for the law and the prophets all speak of me. Amen. His very name. I can imagine how strange maybe it may seem to those that quote these scriptures, the Lord in Hebrew, the Lord is my strength and my song and has become my Yeshua. It's an amazing scripture. Your right hand, O Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, has become glorious in power. Your right hand, O Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, has dashed the enemy in pieces. And the greatness of your excellence, you have overthrown those who rose against you. You sent forth your wrath, it consumed them like stubble, and with the blast of your nostrils the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright like a heap, the depths congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My desire shall be satisfied on them, I will draw my sword, my hand shall destroy them. You blew with your wind, the sea covered them, they sank like lead in the mighty waters. You know, these words of this song, they don't necessarily just roll off your tongue, do they? There's a stanza in one of our anthems, and it says, O Lord our God, arise, scatter our enemies and make them fall. Confound their politics, frustrate their knavish tricks. On thee our hopes we fix. God save us all. That's the third verse of God Save the King, by the way. You don't sing that one too often. Confound their politics. Although that's maybe a good song to sing these days. But here we have this stanza, this scripture, these words of this song, and they don't necessarily roll off the tongue, but they are true nonetheless. With the blast of your nostrils, the waters were gathered together. How did the Red Sea part? What does the Bible say happened all night long? There was an east wind that blew all night long. Did you know that God commands the winds and the waves?
Amen.
He commands all these things. You blew with your wind, the sea covered them, they sank like lead in the mighty waters. This scripture is actually on a famous portrait of Queen Elizabeth I, back in the late 1580s and early 1590s. In 1588, there was a great armada that was traveling up the coast of France toward England and was threatening to invade England. And the English ships were in no way comparable to those great Spanish warships that were coming to invade England. And they knew that in the bowels of those warships was going to be a struggle. There was going to be a prison that was coming. There was going to be no more freedom. The Inquisition, that's the word. The Inquisition was in the bowels of those ships. And the English were in no way comparable to the Spanish Armada. But what happened was a wind blew from the north, and they couldn't come across that English Channel. And it blew them across the way, and the English sent those little English boats, and they set them on fire and let the English boats on fire ram into the Spanish armada. And this is the verse that was given in that portrait that they painted of Queen Elizabeth I at the time. You're blue with your wind, and the sea covered them. God is able to do exceedingly more than we can ask or think. God is able to give us the victory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The right hand of God, your right hand, O Lord, has dashed the enemy in pieces. How many of us pray for the right hand, the hand of God's power, to rise up in our life? Psalm 45:4, God's right hand teaches us. Psalm 48:10, God's right hand is full of righteousness. Psalm 77:10, remembrance of the years of the right hand of the Most High. Psalm 110:1, the Father invites the Son to sit where? At his right hand. Habakkuk 2:16, the cup of God's judgment is held in his right hand. And again, Ephesians 1:20, Yeshua is seated at the right hand of God. Amen. May God raise up his hand today. We need him and his salvation, his deliverance, the Lord, our God, our strength, our song, our salvation.
Amen.
It's not enough just to sing about God. It's not enough just to preach and to say the things we know about him. It needs to be something that is deep within, an understanding, a faith, a belief, a certainty, an assurance of who our God is. For who is like you, O God, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? You stretched out your right hand, the earth swallowed them. You in your mercy have led forth the people whom you've redeemed. You have guided them in your strength to your holy habitation. Who is like our great God in all the plagues of Egypt? All those amazing plagues. Who was like the gods of Egypt? God, our great an awesome creator, the maker of heaven and earth, was far greater than any so-called god in Egypt. Indeed, the plagues of Egypt not only devastated their economy and their land, but actually condemned their so-called gods. Who is like you, O Lord? There's that song, who is like unto thee, O Lord among gods? Who is like unto thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? Who is like unto thee? Who is like unto thee, O Lord among gods? Who is like unto thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? Who is like unto thee? You know, the revivals of the 1970s, one thing that they brought us were scripture songs. The songs that were written in the 1970s and 80s, they came right out of scripture. And I wish we would get back to some of those songs again. Hallelujah. Who is like unto God? In the final, the fourth and fifth stanzas of the Song of Moses in Exodus 15, verses 14 to 18, the people will hear and be afraid. Sorrow will take hold of the inhabitants of Philistia. Then the chiefs of Edom will be dismayed, the mighty men of Moab. Trembling will take hold of them. All the inhabitants of Canaan will melt away. Fear and dread will fall on them. By the greatness of your arm, they will be as still as a stone. It's interesting that when the spies went into the land, not the first time, but the second time, when they were ready to go into the land and they were kept safe at the home of Rahab. And what did Rahab tell the spies that came into her home? We have heard what God did at the Red Sea. We have heard the mighty works of God. And these are the things that we need to realize, that our testimony, our experience, yes, our songs, the things that we speak and say, and all the things that the world hears and understands about us, what would they say today concerning us? What have they heard about us today? Unfortunately, in the last number of years, what the world has heard is, boy, do those Christians fight. Boy, do those Christians split up and do all kinds of things. We don't have the same kind of testimony that we used to have amongst the world. And we need to get that back. We need to take back what Satan has stolen from us. They need to hear and, yes, be afraid. Not afraid of us, but fearing God himself. There needs to be a word. There needs to be a voice that goes out and lets the world know. Till your people pass over, O Lord, till the people pass over whom you have purchased, you will bring them in and plant them in the mountain of your inheritance, in the place, O Lord, which you have made for your own dwelling, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. Are you aware you ultimately will be?
No.
You are on a journey. You, the people, will pass over. Did you know that you are people passing through and passing over all the trials and tribulations of this world? He who endures to the end will be saved. And when we are saved, we will have a testimony of faith and a victory of salvation of Yeshua. They heard of the wonderful things that God had done, and they will hear concerning us. May we go through. Remember Jehoshaphat? I don't expect you to remember him personally, by the way. But King Jehoshaphat went to war, and what did God tell him? Who did God tell him to send in first?
The singers.
The singers, the praisers. You know, in the Scottish Highlands, there would be these wars of the Highlanders, usually warring against the English or whatever. And you know what they would play out in front? What do you think they would play, those Scottish Highlanders?
Bagpipes.
Well, those bagpipes. Well, that wouldn't scare anybody. Who, you know, what would? I just saw a video the other day of these little tykes, 2 years old, learning them to play the bagpipes. Goodness sakes. But we are to go out with a song in our heart. We are to sing the praises of God. We're marching to Zion. And so the song of Moses that is shouted forth, goes forth, yes, after they cross the Red Sea. Imagine singing about the victory over those horses and riders and chariots and Pharaoh himself. What's in your heart? What song of praise is just bubbling up within you? You know, there was a Catholic priest, and bless him, but he was disheartened because they would go to their service every Sunday, and the people would kind of bury their heads in their programs, in their liturgies, and basically just mouth the words. And he got so frustrated, this Catholic priest, he said, oh, come on, can't we sing like Protestants? Because true believers truly have a song. What's the song in your heart? This song of Moses welled up within him. And he sang it, and the people joined in. And then Miriam, remember, she led the women in the dance. Glory to God. It's a, you know, it catches on, doesn't it? The singing. And today we have heard wonderful singing, and we still shall. But instead of a midrash per se, as I mentioned, I would like us to hear some of the favorite songs that maybe you haven't heard for a while. But I would like us, and I'll attempt to play these. If you now just use the one hymn book. Let's not switch between too many song books. But this hymn book, Celebration Hymnal, is there a favorite? I mentioned this earlier.
Be Thou My Vision.
What number is that?
I didn't know if it's in there, but it's my favorite.
Did someone find that? Is that my vision?
It's Irish.
I'm sorry.
This is what we used to call song service.
Bye. 517.
517. Okay. I'm gonna play this in the key that I know.
I was singing.
Redeemer, and his heavenly love to me, how from death to life he's brought me, Son of God, with him to be. Amen. Amen. How many want to hear a little bit more from the Springmans? Hello? Are you here? Do you have two or three more in your repertoire? And by the way, thank you for singing out.
He's a bit of a hard act to follow. If I had known, it's like they say you shouldn't follow that or children on stage. So now it's the one.
might know this song. It's called Grace Like Rain.
Can you, my wife, Julia, is a wizard at the computer. Just today. Thank you for being so quiet while we plug in our things. We need that concentration. Okay. Thank you for laughing, too. Because my kids won't laugh at my jokes anymore. They're all dad jokes. Right? You know this, how that works, right? So I really appreciate it. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see so clearly. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away, they're washed away.
Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away.
they're washed away. From our new record. And I was telling a few people I was talking with earlier, we've had the amazing, I don't want to say luck, because it's not luck, it's just opportunity to meet some great people as we've traveled and toured throughout Canada, the US, and even in Europe on tour. And a number of years ago, we met a guy named Mark Heimerman, who's a producer. He's from Nashville, now lives in Minnesota, but he produced a lot of music for some very, very well-known artists, people like Michael W. Smith and DC Talk and Jackie Velasquez, the Newsboys. And he just has a heart of a child, and he heard our music and decided that he would like to produce our album. So we've had we've had him working with us for the last, been 5 years now, and producing music for us, including a couple of Christmas songs. So if any of you do streaming music, you can find our music on Spotify and Deezer and all the usual places to listen to music. But if you still use CDs, we have some. Because, I mean, how many people here are still, like, you know, we play in high schools and kids look at this CD and they go, what's this? What do you do with this? I'm like, great. You know, I still use cassettes, come on. 8-track cassettes, not the new fancy smaller ones. But anyway, so this is a song from that album, our newest worship album. And we do have some CDs here, that's right. This is called Marvelous. Yes, you should clap your hands.
Oh, what you are.
Let's see, is there one you were mentioning? Watch Me Now, or maybe? Watch Me Now? Okay, all right, this is called Watch Me Now. And it's taken from, I believe it's the book of Matthew, and Jesus is talking about, look at the birds, because he's talking to a bunch of antsy, you know, Jews, probably. And he's saying, what are you worrying about, you know? Just look at the birds. Do they look worried? He's saying, no, and the Father loves them, and he provides for them, and he feeds them. And look at these lilies in the field, and you know, he's just giving examples. All the things that God does, and he loves us so much more than the grass, than the lilies, and the birds. And yet, we worry. So he said, you know, it's almost like it's a surefire remedy for worry. Just go bird watching. And thank God for what you have. So this is called Watch Me Now. Stocking stuffers, right? For Christmas. How many shopping days to Christmas? Anyway, thank you so much for inviting us. We hope to see you again. God bless you.
And thank you so much for coming and blessing us here at Shabbat Shul Shalom. And again, at their CD table, there is a donation basket for them. And please be generous with your donations as well as picking up a CD or two of theirs. Amen. And I will call on Neil, if you would come. Let's stand as we receive the blessing, blessing upon blessing today. Amen. Shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give to you his shalom. I knew I forgot something. Who's going to play the Shabbat medley? Okay. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. I'm the style, I'm the style, I'm the style of life. I'm the style, I'm the style.
Jerusalem shall live in.